Hey YouTube, Joyboy here. So, let's go back to Marineford. What was that conflict about? Saving Ace, yes, of course. But at its heart, it was, I think, more than that. To the government, Ace wasn't just a person, a pirate, a high-ranking member of the Whitebeard Pirates. Ace was a shadow of the man the world government feared, above all others, his father, Gold D. Roger. His birth, they somehow knew, was significant. His death was necessary. They risked conflict with the man called the strongest in the world for the opportunity to kill somebody who could become far greater than that. As we learned in some of the recent chapters of One Piece, Roger was waiting for Joy Boy. Following the clues here is fun. They first learned of Joy Boy from the Poneglyph of Apology in Fishman Island, and then discovered who this person was by reading the story he left at Laughtail. But they discovered even more than this. They led us to believe Joy Boy was a person who lived in the distant past during the Void Century. His story is on the Poneglyphs. He wrote the Poneglyphs. But also Joy Boy was a person who does not yet exist. Odin tells us with startling precision, Joy Boy would come to Wano in 20 years' time. And so he prepared for that inevitability. We all assume that Luffy is Joy Boy, and here Joy Boy is, right on time. But I think that it's important to clarify, even though we learn these specifics from Odin, these are likely conclusions also made by Gold D. Roger. What Odin knows, what Odin learned, and how he learned it, all along the same journey, the same path that Roger himself took with his crew, Odin being a part of that crew. In Fishman Island, they learned that Poseidon would be born in 10 years' time. This was 25 years before the beginning of the story. As Roger finally disbands the Roger Pirates, they again hear that Poseidon is not yet born and will take a further 15 years to grow. Again, 25 years before the current storyline in 15 years plus 10 years, that's present day. Possibly it was from this that Odin knew the exact time that Joy Boy would arrive in Wano. Because from the Sea Kings, he learned the exact year that a great war would unfold. But the Sea Kings were not just waiting on Poseidon. They were anxious for the day that the two sovereigns would meet, the two kings. They believed, surely, this time, it would go well. I would presume in this case, it alludes to the conflict of the Void Century, likely a conclusion also reached by Roger and Odin, having at that time already read the true history and discovered the secrets of the world. 800 years ago, the Ancient Kingdom lost. The Ancient Kingdom, as well as the mermaid princess, the Ancient Kingdom's weapon, Poseidon. So it didn't go well, but this time it will. We don't know exactly where Odin and why Odin jumped to the conclusion that Joy Boy would return, but I presume it was by reading the Poneglyphs, and then perhaps by hearing the Sea Kings also assume that the two sovereigns would meet, meaning Joy Boy and Poseidon, in 25 years. Maybe the Poneglyphs were even more specific than this, and prophesized Joy Boy's specific return to Wano. Here we can really only speculate. All that really matters is it appears as though Odin believes fully and completely that Joy Boy will appear at a specific time, and as far as we know, it's his perspective is trustworthy. He has some inside information somehow. Because again, Luffy is here. And just in general, prophecies do actually exist in the world of One Piece. Charlay from Fishman Island can actually predict the future. This is an actual power that exists. So there remains the possibility that some prophecy may have been recorded on the Poneglyphs, the prophecy of Joy Boy. But anyway, we see during Odin's flashback, Roger speculates, hearing the Sea Kings, that the voices they hear are speaking the truth, that somebody was going to be born and eventually surpass us. And this leads us right back to Ace. Roger says immediately after this, and that person that will eventually surpass us who's going to be born, that person is going to be my son, even though I don't have a son yet. In Gold D. Roger's opinion, what he actually believed, his son would become Joy Boy. And I think Roger's opinion is very influential. Roger, I believe, just the same as Odin, understood that in 25 years, Joy Boy would return, and in so doing, cause a great war that would shake the very foundations of this world. As Whitebeard hints in Marineford, the person Roger was waiting for, searching for, was probably a D, just like himself. We know that the Poneglyphs explain the nature of D, and Roger later understands why the government would want to hide the fact that he was a D, calling him Gold Roger rather than Gold D Roger. Knowing that Joy Boy, probably a D, was not yet born, all Roger could do was wait and prepare the world for this person's return. And as it's sort of implied, one of his last acts before his execution was to simply have a son to create Joy Boy, to change the next era. What we know for sure, guys, Roger did not hide his secrets. Immediately before disbanding the Roger Pirates, he tells his crew that he will seek out Whitebeard. And as we learned earlier in the story, during this meeting, Roger shared all that he had learned with Whitebeard. The meaning of D, the true history. Roger wanted certain people to know the truth to help him prepare for the future. So for Whitebeard and Marineford, yes, he was saving a crew member, a son, and his treasure, a treasure. Part of his treasure, but I believe he also thought he was protecting Roger's dream, the One Piece. Roger believed that his son would become Joy Boy, change the world as it were. Doubtless he told Whitebeard the very same thing. This is hinted at, you know, as Squardo spoke to Whitebeard after stabbing him through the stomach. Squardo believed that Whitebeard saw Ace above everybody else. He believed that Whitebeard intended to make Ace king. And Whitebeard never contradicted him. I think that it's implied that, yeah, Whitebeard was trying to make Ace king. Whitebeard was trying to make Ace what Roger thought he would be, Joy Boy. And in fact, he even thought this, I can't be the strongest forever. If I can help one pirate achieve his destiny, my life will be complete. Isn't that enough? I think he's talking about Ace. Even below this, we can see it pans right to Ace. He believes, just as Roger believed, that Ace would surpass them. He was Joy Boy, and Whitebeard's duty to the world was to save him and protect him until his time came, even if it cost him his life and the lives of all of his other children. That was what Ace was worth. We know that Whitebeard was a member of the Rocks Pirates, and Whitebeard perceived a lot of wrong in the world, and maybe Whitebeard clung on to the hope, belief given to him by Roger that somebody would be born to change this world. And they both, Roger and Whitebeard, assumed that person was going to be Ace. But I think that some people only think about this from one side. I don't think Whitebeard was the only person who understood Ace's importance historically. Why was the world government so concerned with Ace that they would risk fighting the strongest man in the world? Why did the world government hunt down all of those who were connected to Roger? Why were they so sure that Roger had a secret child in the first place? And why exactly did they fear this child so much? If a prophecy is recorded on the Poneglyphs, I would believe that the world government may also be aware of this prophecy. Maybe the government is just as aware as Roger, Odin, and Whitebeard that the great battle looms once more. Joy Boy will appear from among the D, and just as Roger assumes, his child would be the one to usher in this new era. Maybe the world government believes exactly the same thing. Among the celestial dragons, there exists a legend or a rumor, I don't know exactly what you would call it, but that the D are the natural enemies of God. God in this case referring to the celestial dragons. I think that they may be aware of Joy Boy's return and be acting based on that assumption. In this case, the government is not just killing the son of Roger. They are potentially killing the greatest threat to the entire organization that has ever or will ever exist. That has been foretold to come for over 800 years. That then, I think, becomes a battle surely worth it, even if the cost is great. But everything that I've explained up till now is not really the main topic of this theory. This is just sort of the prelude. The picture I painted for you of Marineford is now deeper than it was before, I think. Ace at the center of it all, a great war because people believed that he could be the person that changes the world forever. Let's talk about Roger some more, guys. What do you think Roger did in the time between finding Laughtail, disbanding his crew, and being executed, aside from talking to Whitebeard and making a child with Rouge? You know, in my opinion, surely he did more than this. We just, you know, was it important or not? Did anything of significance occur? In my opinion, guys, I think Roger may have sought out other people. People similar to Whitebeard. People that he respected and or trusted or was interested in and told them about the truth of the world. And it could also be possible that maybe he didn't seek out these people, but he told people who he happened to come across or meet randomly. I don't think Roger was looking to hide these secrets. I think he was just very selective about who he wanted to tell them to. And the specific person I have in mind here, guys, is Monkey D. Dragon. In chapter 507, Robin asked Rayleigh about Laughtail, the Will of D, and the Lost History. And Rayleigh has this to say, "Even if I told you the history now, there's nothing you can do about it. The answer you arrive at may be different from ours." Something about this scene strikes a chord for me. I believe there is a connection here with what Monkey D. Dragon said when first introduced in the story. Monkey D. Dragon says this, "The world is waiting for our answer." Answer to what? Dragon doesn't ever specify, but we can speculate. I believe Dragon's answer and the answer Rayleigh talked about referred to the very same problem. Rayleigh learned the true history, the reason the government has erased this history. But to know this insinuates a desire to, quote, do something about it, as Rayleigh says. He also suggests that there may be multiple solutions. You may arrive at a different answer than us. We know that the conflict of the Void Century related to what is now called the World Government. At this time, skipping all the details, we assume them to have been the villains, and they won. And we also know Dragon directly opposes those who created the World Government, the Celestial Dragons. Perhaps the Revolutionary Army is his answer after learning the truth and experiencing the world. I think that Oda made it clear enough that Rayleigh would have told the Straw Hats everything if they had wanted to know. And Roger was very upfront with Whitebeard. It doesn't seem impossible for Roger to have told somebody else, such as Dragon, you know. And even further than this, Dragon is a D, and Roger likely believed that, you know, it could be he or his future child who would one day prove to be Joy Boy. Perhaps Roger met Dragon, who he knew was a D, and felt it necessary to explain it. We also know that Dragon was there on the day of Roger's execution, which is interesting in that he was the only person shown who was not a pirate. Also, when he first discovered his son, Luffy was a pirate, and he comments to himself, "A pirate, eh? Not a bad idea." This is a revolutionary who sympathizes with pirates, and this also makes sense given that he attended Gold Roger's funeral. Furthermore, the very first time Dragon appears in the story, the very first time, the narrator quotes Gold D. Roger, and all of this takes place again, you know, at the island that Roger was executed, Logtown. But there may be another conversation which alludes to this connection. In the Ace, Sabo, and Luffy flashback, Dragon arrives in Goa Kingdom just after the nobles there initiated a plot to burn Trash Mountain and all the people who lived there while blaming it on pirates. He soon meets Sabo, who explains the situation and, ashamed, laments ever having been born an aristocrat. Dragon tells Sabo this, "I understand. I was born in this country too, but I still don't have the power to change it." And as Rayleigh says, "Even if you knew the truth, there is nothing you can do about it." There is probably a lot of similarity to be found here, in my opinion. The world government founded by nobles and aristocrats, and the ancient kingdom connected in some way to pirates, destroyed amid what was most probably lies. But anyway, guys, I feel that there is a strong connection between Roger and Dragon. We obviously haven't read the true history, but the speculation based on what we know is the Celestial Dragons did all sorts of wrong, the ancient kingdom fought against them, eventually lost, and from their ashes the king's power only grew and the world government was created. The reason the world government does not want the poneglyphs deciphered is by reading them, you would be inspired to declare war against the government and the Celestial Dragons. Just as Rayleigh said, even if you knew the truth, there is nothing you could do about it. Discovering the truth leads to war, which is exactly what Whitebeard mentioned or hinted when he revealed that the One Piece does in fact exist in Marineford. "Sengoku, you and the world government fear the great war that will come to this world one day. Somebody will find the One Piece." Roger was the first to discover the truth after almost 800 years. You know, just a few years later, Dragon created the Revolutionary Army to do just this, declare war on the Celestial Dragons, just as you would think that the poneglyphs would tell you to. And that would be a challenging feat, indeed one that certainly the Strats, at the time that they talked to Rayleigh, wouldn't have been able to even contemplate. In a way, guys, I think Dragon may be a disciple of Roger. And so, guys, if that were true, and Dragon had a conversation with Roger in which Roger explained all that he knew, he would know that the time for the prophesized Great War is now. That's what Odin believed, and that's what I believe that Roger believed. Is it any coincidence that the Revolutionary Army chooses this year to attack the Reverie? Is Dragon trying to be Joy Boy? Or is he just another person trying to set the stage for when Joy Boy is supposed to appear? And so, guys, this takes us back to Ace. Captured and executed, we speculate, in part because, it was believed he could be Joy Boy. And now, ominous before us, we have the supposed capture of Sabo during the Reverie. A lot of things could happen, but the common theory is that we are going to be looking at another Ace-like execution, which in part could inspire or add to a enormous conflict, a great war, or at least the Revolutionary Army against the world government directly, where you would see winners and losers. There are striking parallels between the pre and post time skip of One Piece. Oda takes concepts, alters them, and uses them again, whether it be the feel of an arc or a particular plot, idea, a power, or an exact panel just redrawn and changed. As an example, we're not going to go through all of this, all the time that I talk about this. Alabasta is an arc which describes a Shichibukai trying to take power from an established king secretly. And Dressrosa, post-time skip, is an arc which describes the island after Shichibukai has secretly taken power from an established king. The same concept twisted. And that's how Oda does it. And among other things, many of us believe that Oda is going to do the same sort of thing when it comes to this new Great War arc. It'll be a twisted version of Marineford in some way or another. This is what we believed before something mysterious happened to Sabo. So let's twist Marineford. Ace, presumed Joy Boy, is captured and executed. In this case, Sabo, captured and scheduled to be executed, is attempted to be saved by Dragon, presumed candidate to be Joy Boy. Or looking at this from another angle, could Dragon see Sabo as potentially Joy Boy? Has Dragon reached his own conclusions, his own answers, and does Sabo meet his criteria? Or does Dragon believe in Joy Boy at all? He may have heard these stories from Roger, but that doesn't mean that he reached the same conclusions Roger did and believes the same things. Perhaps Dragon has for the most part ignored the prophecy and relied on the history and believed that the Celestial Dragons must be defeated and that he is the one that needs to do this because he has the ability and it just so happens to have culminated now. Or does Dragon believe that his son Monkey D. Luffy is Joy Boy? I'm not entirely convinced about this one. I think that it's worthy of discussing because it's relevant to this theory, but Dragon hasn't really taken a hands-on approach with Luffy's life, but I don't know how significant that is or is not. Roger really never influenced his son Ace and yet still believed he would be the one to change the world. In my opinion, one of the more epic moments from Marineford, there was many of them, but for me personally, was the moment that Whitebeard acknowledged Luffy. Luffy showed up, and Whitebeard, for the most part, I think dismissed him. But after seeing Luffy fight and his determination, Luffy made a believer out of Whitebeard. Whitebeard came to Marineford, I believe, believing that Ace was supposed to be Joy Boy. But in the middle of that fight, I think that Whitebeard saw the potential that he was wrong, and that person may be Ace's little brother Luffy. He was for sure another worthy candidate. And so just like Ace, Whitebeard made a point to protect him. An equally cool moment would be if Dragon, in a similar situation, saw Luffy in the very same way. But let's go back to the idea that Dragon believes himself to be, or is trying to be Joy Boy, or just trying to do what he thinks is right, which in a way would follow the footsteps of Joy Boy. I think the poneglyphs told Roger that Joy Boy would have, by his side, the three ancient weapons, Poseidon, Uranus, and Pluton. After Roger learned Shirahoshi was not yet born, he comments that they were too early, meaning it was impossible for Roger to be Joy Boy and to accomplish whatever feat he is supposed to do because Poseidon wasn't here and couldn't be by his side. Joy Boy and the ancient weapons' destinies or fates are connected. Does Dragon have an ancient weapon already? If he came to discover Shirahoshi was an ancient weapon, what would happen? Would Dragon demand to use her as a weapon, despite Orohime's conclusion that the ancient weapons were never intended to take lives, but rather instead save them? Based on this theory, Dragon possesses a lot of knowledge, but how he takes this knowledge could be very different to how we as readers or other characters in the story have taken it. We don't see the ancient weapons as weapons, but Dragon may. Weapons to be used in order to destroy evil. If you remember, a noteworthy character who happens to know that Shirahoshi is the ancient weapon Poseidon is Caribou, and during his cover story, what did Caribou become? He became a revolutionary. To what lengths would Dragon go in order to destroy the world government and the celestial dragons? And what kind of moment would that lead to in the story? To me, these feel like important questions to be asking right about now. Kind of a beautiful thought in my mind, Oda-level thinking, is for essentially Roger to have had three disciples of varying natures. On one hand, you have Whitebeard, who essentially believed what Roger believed, that his son would one day become Joy Boy, and tasked himself with his protection. And then on the other hand, you have Dragon, who has taken this in a completely different direction, who either believes himself to be Joy Boy or doesn't believe in Joy Boy. But regardless of this, has taken a very active role in creating the events that Joy Boy is supposed to be a part of or responsible for. And then lastly, you would have Shanks, who chose somebody different and basically allowed destiny to play out as it would. All three of them had their very own answers. But yeah, guys, I thought that this video would be interesting. As always, I am curious as to what you guys think. Share your thoughts in the comment section below. Like the video if you like the video, dislike the video if you dislike the video, subscribe if you want to be notified for my future content. And as always, guys, have a wonderful day.